This evening, as you can see, we're going to do something very different from what we're used to. I want you to recall that we've been 4 weeks in a series on the heart of Christ, the heart of the ultimate servant, Jesus. And we've seen Jesus do some incredible things, and we've seen that he has a heart of humility. Humility that stepped down from heaven to earth, went to the lowest position of a servant, a slave, to the cross, died on the cross, and was raised from the dead. And we saw that in Philippians 2, but then we looked for 3 weeks at John 13 and saw that this picture in John 13 that we have is a picture of Christ stepping down. He stepped down in Philippians 2 from heaven to earth, and in John 13 he stepped down from the table that he was eating at and stooped so low as to wash his disciples' feet. And we saw that in the first century it would have been very rude to come to a meal and not wash your feet. But the disciples were so concerned about who the greatest in the group was that they didn't actually wash their feet, and the feet would be dirty and the feet would stink, and so they're reclining at a table next to their friend who has these stinky, dirty feet, and they're so stubborn that Jesus has to break away from his meal and step down and say, I'll wash your feet. And now tonight, we're going to have an opportunity. As you heard this evening, Jesus actually says in John 13, if I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. So Jesus, the great servant of all, did this for his selfish, sinful disciples. And then he says, go and do the same to one another. And he also says, if we know these things, which you, if you've been here for the 4 weeks, you know what these things mean. He says, if you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. So as I was planning this series, I thought, Lord, have your way and let us do something that's out of the ordinary, and let us ask God for a special blessing tonight, that he would be pleased that we actually do what we know to do. And so tonight we're breaking away and we're doing something that is very practical. And I'm going to ask that you follow Jesus to the same degree as he went to follow him all the way to washing someone's feet. So, let me just give you a couple of brief explanations as to how we're going to do this. You know why now, okay? The why is Christ, because of what he has done for us. Now, how are we practically, all 100, maybe 90, maybe 95 of us, how are all of us going to do this practically this evening? Well, we're going to come down here. We're going to, I'm going to show you. Actually, Jordan, if you would come and let's put this on display. What you're going to do, Jordan, is you're going to come and you're going to take a seat, and I'd like you to take your shoes off, and I'm just going to show you how we're going to wash one another's feet. Now, if this is new for you and uncomfortable for you, and yet you are a Christian, I would encourage you to push through the discomfort, okay? You don't want to miss the blessing that God has for you tonight. You don't want to miss what God will teach you through this. So Jordan has got his feet here, and he's going to put those in the basin, and we've got some towels here. And what we're going to do is we're going to just get down and wash one another's feet. Make sure that your partner has got their toes and the toe jam all the way into the water. And make sure that you can see the lint from the socks. And make sure they have a thorough cleaning. And wash the soles of their feet. And make sure that they get a little foot rub as well for extra kindness. And then I'm going to ask Jordan that you just pull your feet up from the basin here, and I'm going to just dry your foot. There we
toes.
And I'm anticipating that some of you are saying, I wish I would have known because I would have taken a bath or a shower. But that's okay. A couple of things here. First of all, if you want to keep the towel, I'd encourage you to do that. Bring this home if you want to keep it as a keepsake. Some of you are saying, you're ridiculous. Some of you might want to, and I don't have anything, there's no problem with that if you want to just set it aside as a special time to remember what Christ has done. Now, I've done Jordan's feet. The water's nice and used, thank you. Okay, we have two basins for each station, so now Jordan is gonna actually wash my feet. So I'm gonna take a seat here. And it might be humiliating for you to wash feet, but you might actually be okay with, you might think that it's easier to wash feet than to have your feet washed, but just let God work tonight and humble yourself. Oh, there you go. Humble yourself to do each, okay? So let your feet be washed and also wash feet tonight. You have size 14 shoes, Tim? You might need to put one foot in at a time, okay? Are you 15? 16? Well, if you have one big foot, put one big foot in at a time, okay? Big foot, that's all it is. It's okay, it's all right if you have big feet. Now you might be saying, I actually have athlete's foot, Kenny, I can't do this, I have plantar warts, this is gross, I can't quite do this. If that's the case, honestly, then you can ask that your hands would be washed by the person tonight, okay? But I encourage you to get involved in the exercise. And if in the rare case that you're saying, absolutely not, under no circumstance will I actually go to that station tonight. Again, I'd encourage you to push through the awkward, but if that's you, then I just ask that you would just quietly observe the night, okay? So we're gonna have some leaders now. If those of you that know who you're grabbing and you're gonna serve, please come forward. We have, thank you, Jordan, for volunteering. And the leaders will grab their person that they'd like to serve tonight, and everybody here tonight will be served. So we need a few people as these basins are being taken out to run with me. Oh, one thing. Hey, friends, we're gonna have music on, but it's reflective, and this is a guy-girl activity, okay? So guys, you are not washing that cutie's feet, okay? And girls, you are not washing that handsome young man's feet, okay? That is not happening, okay? Girls with girls and guys with guys. Unless you're married, I guess I'll make that qualifier.
What about engaged?
Whoa, don't say that.
No, not engaged. And there is Purell up here as your. Yeah, there is. Purell.
Yeah.
take a look at the artwork, reflect on passages. If you have those handouts, you can journal. I want you to really just ask God what he's telling you to do. So reflect.
I am now.
Thank you.
5 more minutes.
Of course. We've got like a time for this.
Yeah, I just want to make sure I get good stuff.
If you have a dirty basin, please let me know. Continue to reflect, please.
Thank you.
Thank you.
13.
You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example, that you also should do just as I have done to you. Truly, truly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. I pray that you were blessed as you wash feet and as you reflected on Christ, who did that as well. As we transition this evening from foot washing, I want to remind you that on the night that Jesus washed feet is also the night that he instituted the Lord's Supper. The symbolism is rich. If you look at the New Testament, Jesus is known as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And it was on Passover night that Jesus ate with his disciples and instituted a new ordinance for the church to remember what he has done for her. And so what we're going to do now is we're not done in here tonight. We are going to take time to reflect on what the Lord has done for us, and we're going to take and eat of the Lord's Supper. So these are the elements, and we have a gluten-free option as well for those of you that are gluten-free. So I encourage every one of you to participate. But I want to just show you from the New Testament where the Lord's Supper comes from and grab a couple of nuggets from it as we read through it, okay? So 1 Corinthians 11, if you have your phone or your Bible, is where we hear of the Lord's table being instituted. So 1 Corinthians 11, and I'm going to read, and then I'm just going to take time to talk to you about a few things as we come and take the Lord's Supper. So, it was on the night that Jesus was betrayed that he said these words. 1 Corinthians 11, verse 17. But in the following instructions, I do not commend you, this is Paul speaking to the church at Corinth, because when you come together, it is not for the better, but for the worse. For in the first place, when you come together as a church, I hear that there are divisions among you, and I believe it in part. Apparently, the rich people were having a great old feast, and they weren't sharing that feast with the poor people in the church. For there must be factions among you in order that those who are genuine among you may be recognized. When you come together, it is not the Lord's Supper that, is it not? It is not the Lord's Supper that you eat. For in eating, each one goes ahead with his own meal. One goes hungry, another gets drunk. What? Do you not have houses to eat and drink in? Or do you despise the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I commend you in this? No, I will not. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. But if we judged ourselves truly, we would not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined so that we may not be condemned along with the world. So then, my brothers, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. If anyone is hungry, let him eat at home, so that when you come together, it will not be for judgment. About the other things, I will give directions when I come. So there's a couple things that I want us to take a minute with this evening. You could tell that we've slowed down this evening, and we're not rushing out of here. But when we're talking about the Lord's Supper, it was on that night that he washed his disciples' feet that he instituted the Lord's Supper. And as we eat the bread tonight, I want everyone here to slow down and pause from the busyness, the thoughts in your mind, the stress in your life, and think again about what Christ has done for you. I know at this hour it might be stretching, and I hope that you're able to, by faith, trust in the Lord. When we take the bread and drink the juice, we're making a statement. We're actually proclaiming the Lord's death for us. It's like a tactile way, a visual, and a way that we can actually proclaim that the Lord has died for us. When we're eating the bread, we're celebrating Jesus' death for us as his people and us personally as his children. But just to clarify, the Lord's Supper is a family meal. If you're not yet a Christian, I'd love to talk to you about how you can become a Christian, but this meal is not yet for you. So I'd encourage you, if you're not a Christian, to just observe the evening. This is a serious matter, as we've already read. We want to take this meal and eat this bread and drink this wine in a manner worthy of the Lord, so as not to keep up judgment on ourselves and be disciplined by the Lord. That's what happened in Corinth, that apparently God was so serious about what they were doing at the Lord's table that some of them were even dying for their unworthy ways of taking the Lord's Supper. So I encourage you to observe respectfully what we're doing tonight. This meal is a meal for the family, those who are in the family of God. As we take the meal together, we're saying that we have personally received Jesus, and who is the bread of life, and whose body was broken for us. Regularly recalling Jesus' death is good for us for many reasons, but for the reason tonight, I want you to remember the length and depth and height and width of God's love for you. His Son was sent to be the Savior of the world, and his Son was sent to die and to break his body for your sake. Now I want you to just take a minute to examine your heart. There's a couple of phrases in this passage that you might have noticed are personally convicting and challenging. It says in verses 23 to 26, as often as you eat, you drink, and you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. But he says in verse 27, whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of Jesus. Let a person, verse 28, examine himself or herself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. So if you're a Christian and you're going to partake in the Lord's table tonight, I encourage you to examine your heart. And in Matthew 5, Jesus talks about making sure that we, if we're going to offer a gift at the altar, remember that if our brother has something against us, leave the gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother and then come and offer your gift. The Corinthian church was not loving one another well. And they needed to be reminded of examining their heart. Examining their heart, is there anything or anybody in your life that you need to seek forgiveness from? Is there anybody in the room tonight that you need to just say, hey, before I eat this and partake of this special meal, I need to say sorry for something I've done. I repent. I've done you wrong. I encourage you to do that before you come forward and eat. So, we're going to break the bread and we're going to drink. And I encourage you, if you're believers and you're going to do this, that you can come down. Let me just give you the visual that Jesus Christ's body was broken for us, and that he shed his blood for us. So let me pray, and then those of you that are Christians, I encourage you to come down the center aisle and then grab a piece of bread and grab a piece of juice and just go that way to your seat, please. Okay? Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for sending your son Jesus. As we now reflect on what you have done for us in sending your son, I do pray now that everyone here would examine their own hearts first and would say, Lord, if there's any wickedness in me, I repent. Lord, if there's any resentment or anger in me, seeking to make it right, I will say I'm sorry. And Lord, cleanse us, remind us of what your son has done as we eat this bread and drink this juice. In Jesus' name, amen. So now the music is going to play, and as you do some reflecting, when you're ready, please come forward. We'll have about 10 more minutes of this to take the bread and reflect and drink the juice. Thank you. Said, but that was totally fine. You were to eat that whenever you were ready. So, but for those of you that are just waiting, and that's totally fine, we'll just read this together one more time. Paul says, I have received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, also he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Our Father in heaven, thank you so much for this special night. Pray that your Spirit would move in our hearts. Let us feel, enjoy, celebrate your love in sending your Son, who was crushed for us. Let us celebrate and rejoice in him. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Now we're going to have the last song, and the cups will be, there will be a couple of bowls that are passed around to pick up the cups. So if you'd like to stand, please do, and I'll be giving some bowls to you so you can pick your cup again.
Mercy. Yeah.